Well, going back to our top story this evening, we're now joined on the line from Seoul by CNN correspondent Kyung La. She's going to give us more details on the situation in the Korean Peninsula. Good evening from Manila, and thanks for joining us.
No problem.
All right, so let me just read to you what the South Korean president said in a statement. I think it was over the weekend. She said, if there's any provocation against South Korea and its people, then there should be a strong response in initial combat without any political consideration. Spell this out for us, please. What does this mean when they say a strong response in initial combat? What should the world expect from the South?
It's very simple. To put it in playground terms, you hit me, I'll hit you back. And she spoke very simply and very clearly and directed the message to North Korea. What she's trying to say is, looking back on 2010, when South Korea had small skirmishes with North Korea, the shelling of an island that killed 4 people, the sinking of a naval ship that killed nearly 40 sailors, she's looking specifically at those events, and she is warning North Korea, you mess with us, we're going to mess you right back. Mm-hmm. And that's, it's a very, very simple message. Mm-hmm. What's concerning to the international community is this is yet again making this peninsula, pushing up the tensions on the peninsula. There is strong concern from the U.S. Pentagon that what we are looking at now is not necessarily the brink of war, but the risk of miscalculation, that there could be a trip, that there could be a mistake, and that South Korea, and by default, by treaty, the United States, then gets sucked into some sort of major conflict.
All right. Now, before we got to you on air, we had a report and we were able to, our news team was able to speak with a Filipina who is in Seoul as we speak. And she said things there are pretty normal. They have sales there. They don't feel that they're on the brink of war. Tell me something. How drastic will the changes be once the situation points to the tensions escalating into a full-blown war?
Well, it's very hard to think about anything beyond just tensions because this has been going on for so many decades. The idea of war in this peninsula is unimaginable. Seoul, which has 11 million people just in this immediate area, you spread it out to the surrounding areas, and we're talking about 24 million people just within stone's throw of the border of North Korea. If there's even a conventional war that strikes Seoul, we're talking about millions of people who could be killed very, very quickly. So when you were talking to that Filipina who says things feel very normal, it's because it's almost unimaginable, it's almost unthinkable that there could be a war. Mm-hmm. North Korea doesn't want a war, because if there's war, it is the elimination of the regime, and they know that. So what is at stake here is whether or not there's going to be some sort of mistake that leads to a larger conflict.
What kind of mistake will that be, if in case that happens?
So let's say that there is some sort of fire between North Korea and South Korea at sea. There's an exchange of gunfire, and then that leads to South Korea reacting and shelling North Korea across the border, and then North Korea fires back. That's how quickly a situation can escalate. Then the United States gets involved. Then what happens then? Does it bomb Pyongyang? These are all questions that it's very, very difficult to sort of imagine. You can think about it, but to play out those cards is really horrifying. Mm-hmm. And I haven't even talked about the fact that North Korea, for the first time in our history, we have a regime, a totalitarian regime, with a nuclear weapon.
Right.
If they feel cornered, analysts believe that they already believe that the regime will be wiped out. If you have a nuclear bomb, what do you do then?
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I say it's almost unimaginable.
Mm-hmm. Let's get into that deeper now. Now, many watchers have been saying that it's nothing but the North's hostile rhetoric towards the South. But given that we know little about the North's new leader, do you think that he will make good on the threats that he's been making, even if many watchers have said that it's nothing but just hostile rhetoric?
It's hard to say. We know so little about him. And if you think about his age, 28, 29 years old, he's lived a sheltered life, shoved into this position, you know, very, very late. He didn't expect to be in this job. He's unpredictable. And that's what is one wild card here.
Mm-hmm.
He is very unpredictable. There's so little known about him. Maybe he is this crazy. Maybe he's not. We just don't know. Mm-hmm. And analysts can think about this all day long, but none of us live there. Mm-hmm. None of us have interviewed him. None of us know anything about him. So that's what's very difficult.
Right. Right. And to many, this further just underscores the miscalculation or the threat of miscalculation that you were talking about a while ago.
Yes, absolutely. That's a big concern here from the U.S. Pentagon.
All right. Now, let's talk about the Seoul's Unification Ministry. Has this entity been relevant at all in the last decade or so? And how hard will their task be protecting the South Koreans who are working in North Korea?
Well, I think you're asking about whether or not we're looking at a unified peninsula, because the Unification Ministry specifically works for that. And at this point, the idea of a unified peninsula, that's not just on the back burner, it's on a cold burner. It's going to be very difficult to move in that direction. The sentiment among South Koreans is that at this point, looking at a unified Korea is going to be very difficult. When it was a bit more liberal in this country, that's something that you've certainly heard quite a bit of, especially from the younger generation, looking toward a continent that can't live in a state of Cold War anymore, a country that really is... We're talking about ethnically the same people, so we're divided on the political line.
Right.
So the idea is to one day unify the peninsula, but with all of this hostility coming from a young leader who's got a long life ahead, it's hard to be optimistic about a unified peninsula.
All right. I asked you that question because there was a report saying that the Seoul's Unification Ministry is now just focusing on its citizens who are working at the Kaesong Industrial Complex. And that's their main focus right now.
Right. What's happening at Kaesong is it's a unique facility. It's a facility, an industrial complex. It's actually in North Korean territory. But it's Korean companies with North Korean employees. So these are South Korean managers with North Korean employees. And North Koreans make a good living. They make a good wage there. And this is one of the few spots in North and South Korea where you have Koreans working side by side, right, working to create something. Mm-hmm. And so it's really been seen as a ray of hope. But what North Korea has said and what they're actually doing is very different. What they have said is that they want to cut this off. But today, it was business as usual. There were South Koreans and North Koreans going to Kaesong and still working. And it appears, and again, you have to not just listen to what North Korean says, mm-hmm, but you have to look at what they do.
Okay.
They haven't cut off access to that
And
yet.
As we wrap up this interview, let's set our sights on the U.S. and the whole international community. What do you think? What effect will this have on the region and the U.S.? Can the U.S. afford to support another war?
Absolutely. It is something that the U.S. does not want, and it doesn't want it on a number of levels. Number one, it would be devastating for this peninsula. It would be devastating in terms of lives, and, you know, South Korea is an ally of the United States. That is something that, you know, the United States will say again and again, everyone we talk to, you know, that is something you have to avoid. Again, it's almost unthinkable. The idea of what it may do economically to this entire region is also almost unthinkable. You look at East Asia, it is the world's third largest economic area behind the United States and the EU. Mm-hmm. It would have an impact on the entire world, the entire global market. It would affect China, one of the largest emerging economy in the world. It would affect Russia, it would affect Japan, it would affect the Philippines. Mm-hmm. Everyone here would be affected, and that would affect the global economy. And so the idea of a war here, and whether or not the U.S. militarily could handle it, they don't even want to go there. They just simply want to avoid it.
Well, CNN correspondent Kyung Lau reporting to us from Seoul. We appreciate you for joining us tonight. Have a good evening, and thanks.